Bam! Mr. Tarrou, in this AP Calculus review, we're going to be doing two examples of finding equations of tangent lines. And this is a seventh part in a series of videos I'm doing to help you prepare for the multiple choice questions, that's what these are inspired by, that you may see on your AP Calculus exam, and possibly some free responses as well. We have here as our first example, the line y equals mx plus b with b is greater than or equal to 4 is tangent to the graph of f of x is equal to negative x minus 3 squared plus 4 at the point, or at a point, in the first quadrant. What are all possible values of b? Now, of course, as we think about solving these problems, especially the free response questions, you know, we have to validate our solutions using calculus, but that doesn't mean we throw all the geometry and all of our other tools that are in our toolbox out the window. So if I'm going to do this problem, I'm going to give myself a picture of what's going on to help me solve the solution. I'm just really visual. I need that. So as we're thinking through this problem, we have, of course, a parabola opening down. This is in vertex form or standard form or whatever particular book you were studying called it. But we have a vertex here at 3, 4, and it's opening down. So we have a vertex at 1, 2, 3, and up 4. It's opening down. Maybe we don't necessarily need a wonderful picture here to help us solve the problem, but it's a good chance it might help. So let's go ahead and find the x-intercepts. So we have 0 is equal to negative x minus 3 squared plus 4. Go through a little bit of work here. Okay, so of course, you know, when you introduce your own even root to both sides of an algebraic equation, we have to account for both the positive and negative answer, and we have x-intercepts of 1 and 5. Now, as I look at my picture here, if I focus on just the part of this question that says our point of tangency is in the first quadrant, then we can have tangent lines that, you know, within the first quadrant, we have a parabola opening up. Maybe we have a tangent line here and it's going up very sharply or horizontal, or a tangent line that has a negative slope. But the second piece of information that we have to think about or consider, the second condition, if you will, is not only that our tangent line is going to be in the first quadrant, but that the y-intercept of our tangent line has to be greater than or equal to 4. So considering a tangent line that touches over here, you know, of course with a positive slope, we're going to have a y-intercept that's obviously less than less than 4. But we want a y-intercept which is greater than or equal to 4. So here's 4, and yes, with the vertex of that parabola, all of a sudden having a picture of this graph is becoming very helpful. This is, you know, kind of like, well, one possible equation of the tangent line is simply y equals 4. But we're not looking for the equation of the tangent line. We're just looking at what are all the possible values that b, the y-intercept of our tangent line, can take on. Well, as we allow x to go to the right here, basically between the x value of 3 and 5, we're going to have tangent lines that have more and more negative slopes until this parabola, the slope is going to, well, I guess you could argue the slope is going to continue to fall forever once you're to the right of x equals 3, but that point of tangency is defined as being, you know, within the first quadrant. So we can approach 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that x-intercept of 4. We can let x go all the way up to 4.9999, all the way up to approaching 5. And, you know, then you can say, well, is the x-axis actually in the first quadrant, or is it between quadrant 1 and 4? But we're going to go ahead and analyze what's happening here at the x value of 5. So we want the equation of this blue tangent line. And then ultimately, you know, what values of b, what can it take on? Well, it's going to be somewhere between 4 and, you know, whatever we happen to see when we find the y-intercept of that blue tangent line. So what do we need to solve this problem? Well, that's what you need to figure out. No. So we went ahead and found that derivative, showing the use of the chain rule there, even though, of course, the derivative of x minus 3 is equal to 1. Distribute the negative 2, plug in our x value of 5, and the slope of our parabola at the x value of 5 comes out to be negative 4. And, of course, we know we're in calculus. To write the equation of a line, all you need is a point and a slope. There's our point, the value of 0 and 5 going in for y and x, bringing in our slope of negative 4. And the y-intercept of this blue line, as I was drawing this, I hope I was not, you know, going to find out the answer was like 15 when it was way off, you know, and when I drew the line is going way off the board. But we were told that this y-intercept had to be greater than or equal to 4. We've got this yellow tangent line as we move to the right between that x value of 3 and 5. Once again, that slope is going to go down, the y-intercept is going to go up, and our values of b are going to be between 4 and 20. And that is the end of our first example. The second example is going to involve looking at values of our function and our derivative as it's given to us in a table of values. And for our second example, we have let f of x be a differentiable function defined only on the interval from negative 4 to 12, that closed interval with the equal signs. The table below gives us the values of f of x and its derivative f prime of x at several points along the domain. The tangent line to the graph of f of x and parallel to the segment between the endpoints of our closed interval here of f of x intersects the y-axis where? What theorem really is this question about? You might see parallel. Okay, we're going to find the equation of a line, endpoints of a segment. So you might just, you know, use our endpoints here of negative 4 and 12, find that average rate of change. Hopefully, since we're talking about f prime, you think about, okay, we need that instantaneous rate of change and get to the correct answer. But if this were a free response question and you didn't show any evidence of checking the conditions and stating what theorem you're using to solve the solution, you're going to lose a lot of points. So what is this problem about? We have slopes of segments between endpoints. Well, that's average rate of change. And we have f prime, or equations of tangent lines. Well, that's when we start talking about instantaneous rate of change. Mean value theorem. Now, of course, don't forget, as we review for the AP calculus exam, we have a mean value theorem for integration and derivatives. And for derivatives, our mean value theorem, a continuation or an expansion of the Rolle's theorem, says if f is continuous on a closed interval and differentiable on the open interval. Well, on a free response question, if you're told that a function is differentiable, then by default, it's going to be continuous. Now, not all continuous functions, of course, remember, are going to be differentiable. You can't take a derivative at a sharp bend. But if it's differentiable, then it's guaranteed to be continuous. So you can say, well, since the function f is differentiable, it is continuous, and therefore by the MVT, or the mean value theorem, and then move on to, you know, solving your problem. But you've stated that you know the conditions are differentiable and continuous, and you've stated what theorem you're using to solve the problem. But at any rate, if f is continuous on the closed interval and differentiable on the open interval, then there exists a c on f, or between the, or within the open interval, excuse me, from a to b, such that f prime of c is equal to f of b minus f of a over b minus a. Or in other words, if you meet all the conditions of the mean value theorem, you're guaranteed a c such that the instantaneous rate of change, the slope of the tangent line, is equal to the average rate of change, or the slope of that secant line. And that's basically all we have to do with this problem. Find the slope of the secant line, the segment between some endpoints on a closed interval, that average rate of change, and use it to find that point C where the instantaneous rate of change is equal to the average rate of change. And that'll help us set up the equation of the tangent line and ultimately solve the problem. There's my big piece of chalk so I can easily write. So our average rate of change, nothing more really than the slope formula. Basically, so y sub 2 minus y sub 1 over x sub 2 minus x sub 1 Okay, so our average rate of change on the closed interval from negative 4 to 12 is equal to negative 4. Not so important on multiple choice questions, but on a FRQ, you got to be specific, because the average rate of change between negative 2 and 8 is not the same as between negative 4 and 12. So, let's see. The mean value theorem guarantees that existence, our function is differentiable and therefore also continuous, differentiable on the open interval, continuous on the closed. Let's find that C. So, our average rate of change is 4. Okay, well, look along here. We're given values for the derivative, that instantaneous rate of change, and voila! We have an instantaneous rate of change of negative 4, like our average rate of change, at the x value of 4. Now, the line tangent to the graph, of course, if you want the equation of a tangent line, like we just saw in the previous example, you need a point, and our point is 4, 8. Don't use the y value from the derivative. The instantaneous rate of change, the slope of the tangent line at the x value 4, is equal to that average rate of change that we're after, negative 4. Let's find that equation of the tangent line and finish our problem. And we were not asked for the equation of the tangent line. We were asked about where it intersects the y-axis. What's the y-intercept? And voila, it is right there. And that's the end of this review video. I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go do your homework.